Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala hama ba'd. So now today, inshallah ta'ala, we will begin with the biography of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. And we will jump right in. Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhu, we already mentioned the story of Abbas, we already mentioned he's from the Ahlul Bayt. He was born when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was suffering the boycott. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not living in Mecca, he was living in the Sha'b, in the valleys of the Bani Hashim, the Banu Abdul Muttalib, outside the city of Mecca. And it is said that when he was born, Abbas radiallahu an wrapped him up in a blanket and took him outside the city to show the Prophet basically his cousin, because Abdullah ibn Abbas is the Prophet's cousin. And this also shows us the fondness that Abbas had, and also that in reality, if he wasn't a secret Muslim, he was very sympathetic to Islam. As I mentioned last week, we already mentioned the story of Abbas. At this point, he's not a Muslim, but his sympathies are with Islam, and his love is for the Prophet ﷺ, not just a natural, but a religious love as well. And so he brought Abdullah ibn Abbas to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet ﷺ made dua for him, the first of many duas. So he made dua, essentially the day he was born, or the day after he was born. And he said that, may this child be a blessing for you. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then did tahniq of Ibn Abbas. What is tahniq? Who can remind me? What is tahniq? So you take some date, what do you do with it? You chew it. And then you put it inside of the mouth of the baby, and you basically feed the baby that date. Now, there was one problem about tahniq at this stage. What might that be? No tamr, exactly. No tamr. Why is there no tamr? The boycott. They don't have any food. They don't have any food. And so the Prophet ﷺ did tahniq only with his saliva. And it is said this is the only person whom the Prophet made tahniq just with his saliva into the mouth of Ibn Abbas. So clearly there's going to come barakah now from the mouth of Ibn Abbas, because we believe in the Prophet's barakah. We believe that the Prophet's body and all that comes from him and his saliva and his hair has barakah. So there's no question that now that this saliva has entered into the mouth of Ibn Abbas, that there will be barakah coming from the mouth of Ibn Abbas, which is obviously exactly what has happened. And many years later, so remember, Ibn Abbas is born in Mecca and he remains in Mecca until the 8th year of the Hijrah, when his father Abbas decides to migrate, remember? And when he's migrating, he meets the Prophet on the way to the conquest, so they don't actually go to Medina at this point in time. Ibn Abbas, when he quoted the verse in the Quran, Surah An-Nisa, verse 98, Surah An-Nisa, verse 98, which obligates Hijrah on all of the Muslims. It was wajib to make Hijrah for the people of Mecca. They were not allowed to remain in Mecca. Then Allah makes an exception. إِلَّا الْمُسْتَضْعَفِينَ مِنَ الرِّجَالِ وَالنِّسَاءِ وَالْوِلْدَانِ الَّذِينَ لَا يَسْتَطِيعُونَ حِيلَةً وَلَا يَهْتَدُونَ سَبِيلًا فَأُولَٰئِكَ عَسَى اللَّهُ أَنْ يَعْفُوَ عَنْهُمْ. So Allah says, everybody must make hijrah except those who are genuinely weak and incapacitated from amongst the men and the women and the children. Perhaps these people Allah will forgive. Ibn Abbas recited this verse when he was much, much, much older. And he said, I am from this ayah. My mother was from the mustada'afin of the Nisa, and I was from the mustada'afin of the Wildan. Okay, so I am from this ayah. I am from this exception. What does this show? This shows that Ibn Abbas was raised as a Muslim by his mother, even when his father was not a Muslim. Ibn Abbas was raised as a Muslim by his mother. Remember we said yesterday, last Wednesday, we said that the mother of Abbas radiallahu ta'ala an, sorry, the mother of Ibn Abbas, the wife of Abbas, was a Muslim. Umm al-Fadl, she had embraced Islam from the very beginning. We said she was the second female convert after Khadija radiallahu anha. So Ibn Abbas was raised a Muslim. And he says, I couldn't make the hijrah because I was a kid. It's not my fault. And Allah says, إِلَّا الْمُسْتَضَعَفِينَ. My mother was a mustada'af, I was a mustada'af. We could not make a hijrah. So the Prophet ﷺ, sorry, Ibn Abbas did not see the Prophet ﷺ essentially for the next 8 years. When is he going to see him? There's no contact. So Ibn Abbas grows up and there's no memories he would have had from Mecca, because he was probably 2 years old, maximum 3 years old, when the Prophet ﷺ made Hijrah. So Ibn Abbas has not interacted with the Prophet ﷺ at all. His era, he became the greatest, not one of the greatest alim of his time. No one competed with Ibn Abbas when it came to each and every science of Islam, and he was one of the first polymaths. He was the scholar of tafsir, the scholar of hadith, the scholar of fiqh, the scholar of everything, of language, of poetry. Ibn Abbas became the greatest alim of the era of the late Sahaba, because he was a young Sahabi, so he lived past the major Sahaba. When all the major Sahaba passed away, he was still alive for another 30 years. He became the greatest alim of that generation, and that's why he is called Habr al-Ummah, as we said 2-3 weeks ago. That is the title of Ibn Abbas, Habr al-Ummah. And Habr, it was typically used to indicate rabbi, and it's also used to indicate an academic, a scholar. So Habr al-Ummah is the scholar of the Ummah, and he's also called Tarjuman al-Quran, or the interpreter of the Quran. Also, Ibn Abbas is amongst the five most copious narrators of hadith. Okay, so there are five great narrators of hadith who have narrated the bulk of our tradition. These are the giants of narrating hadith. Who is number one out of all of them? Everybody, please tell me you know this. Abu Huraira, Zakumullah Khair. Abu Huraira. I quiz my students all the time. I should cut back because it's sometimes not very positive. Alhamdulillah. Anyway, alhamdulillah. All of you guys are good. Alhamdulillah. Just kidding with you guys. So, the greatest is who? Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu. I don't expect you to know the rest of them in order, but guess who would be amongst the five? Aisha. Definitely Aisha is amongst the five. In fact, she is number two. So definitely Aisha is there as well. Who else would be amongst this five? So we have two of them. We already mentioned that Ibn Abbas is there. So we have two left. MashaAllah, smart. We have two left. Who is there? Jabir and Anas ibn Malik. And Ibn Umar. Jabir is number six, sorry. Ibn Umar. Abdullah ibn Umar and Abdullah ibn Abbas. They are both of the greatest of the narrators. So we have Abu Hurairah, Aisha, Abdullah ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Abbas, and Anas ibn Malik. Okay? These five are the most copious or the most frequent narrators of hadith. Now, add two more, and that is Jabir ibn Abdullah and Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, and you have the seven Sahaba who narrated more than 1,000 hadith. Only these seven. They narrated more than 1,000 hadith. Ibn Abbas narrated around 1,660 hadith. Okay? So Ibn Abbas narrated 1,660 hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now, the majority of these hadith, he did not hear himself, because he was only 2 years with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So who is he narrating from then? The rest of the Sahaba, including his father. And he doesn't mention many times who he heard it from. Sometimes he does. Why? Because we don't care who he heard it from. The Sahaba are all righteous and authentic. So we don't care if he heard it from Aisha, if he heard it from Jabir, if he heard it from Anas. If he doesn't matter to us. Sahabi narrates, even if he didn't hear from the Prophet directly, that missing link is irrelevant to us. Every other missing link is extremely relevant. But a Sahabi narrating from another Sahabi from the Prophet ﷺ, whether he mentions the middle Sahabi or not, it doesn't really matter, because all of the Sahaba, it doesn't matter. So what if he did? Or if he didn't? Is the authenticity of the hadith going to change? No. So we don't care who the middle people are. Also, Ibn Abbas narrated that to his students, that he saw Jibreel twice. So we'll mention one of these narrations as well. He saw Jibreel twice. So he told his students this as well, that he was of the few people who was blessed or fortunate to see Jibreel. However, obviously when he saw Jibreel, Jibreel was not in his original form, because we know only the Prophet ﷺ saw Jibreel in his original form. And we have a few narrations, not that many, that show us some of the relationships of the Prophet ﷺ with his young cousin. With his young cousin, 50 years his junior, Ibn Abbas, right? So Abdullah Ibn Abbas is a first cousin, but there is a massive age gap, almost 50 years age gap between the two. And One of the beautiful narrations we have, I was a little bit lazy, instead of translating, I just brought the books with me, but at the same time I also wanted to show you some of the books, and also to demonstrate as well that, as you all know, I am going back to the original sources and getting some of these information. I don't just copy and paste from tertiary books. So this is one of the most famous books of hadith. It is Al-Mu'jam Al-Kabir of Al-Tabarani. Actually, this is the second largest collection of hadith after, what's the largest collection? What's the largest collection? The largest collection, definitely not Bukhari. The largest, the most copious. Tabari is a tafsir. Musnad Imam Ahmad has around 40,000. Musnad Imam Ahmad, that's the largest. Musnad Imam Ahmad, I bring it almost every few weeks. I bring the Musnad of Imam Ahmad. And I said it's been printed in 50 volumes. The second largest, or some would say the third, but it's within that region, is this book, Al-Mu'jam Al-Kabir of Al-Tabarani. Al-Tabarani is the last of the great muhaddithin, the last of the great muhaddithin of that era. And he wrote many books. His largest is Al-Mu'jam Al-Kabir. And in it, we have a very beautiful narration that we're going to use to talk about Ibn Abbas and the Prophet ﷺ. So we have over here, Ali ibn Abdullah ibn Abbas narrated from his father, Abdullah ibn Abbas, from his father Abbas. What a beautiful chain. Father, son, grandson, all three are narrating. Okay? So Ali is narrating from Abdullah, from his father Abbas. So all three are there in this chain. That Abbas sent Ibn Abbas, his son, to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and said to him that, go to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and spend the night with him and monitor his salah. So what's happening here? Al-Abbas is sending the little boy, Abdullah, the little boy, to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, go pray Isha with him and then spend the night with him and tell me how he prays Salat al-Tahajjud. What a beautiful hadith. Now, why can this little boy go to the household of the Prophet ﷺ? Who will remember? Who? Very good. MashaAllah. This is correct. Alhamdulillah. Maymuna is? Abdullah ibn Abbas is who? Aunt. Khala. Maymuna is the khala of Abdullah ibn Abbas. So, this is his aunt. And he's just a little kid, like 11 years old. So he's not baligh yet. He's not, even if he were, I mean, it's his aunt. But I'm saying he's just a child at this time. And Abbas knows that the Prophet would not mind if Abdullah ibn Abbas, you know, spends the night with his khala. And so Abdullah ibn Abbas goes to the Prophet, prays Isha with him, and he waits until the Prophet finishes his salah. Everybody has left the masjid except the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He passes by and he sees a figure in the dark. He says, who is this? Abdullah ibn Abbas said, it is Abdullah ibn Abbas. Famah, what is the matter? What is going on? So Abdullah ibn Abbas says, Al-Abbas ordered me to spend the night with you. The child is giving the command. My dad said, I have to spend the night with you. Okay? So the Prophet said, come with me then. And when he came, he said to Maymuna, put the bed for Ibn Abbas. So in this narration, we don't study this. In another narration, we learn that Maymuna and the Prophet slept on one angle. The room was so small, they don't have like, you know, multiple chambers or whatnot. And then Abbas slept on the other angle at their feet. Okay? So they're sleeping here and he's sleeping there. And that's all they have. There's no multiple rooms, there's no three-story houses, mashallah, like us, and seven bedrooms, nothing like that. It's one room, khalas. And so if Abdullah ibn Abbas is going to spend the night, he has to sleep in the very chambers of the Prophet ﷺ, and there's no space even to sleep this side or that side. He has to go to the feet. And so he sleeps this way, and they are sleeping in this way. We learned this from another hadith over here. So we get back here, and Abdullah ibn Abbas said, and Abbas had told me, do not go to sleep until you monitor his salah. So the child is now fighting sleep, subhanAllah, to monitor the salah of the Prophet ﷺ. And so the Prophet ﷺ lied down and he went to sleep until I could hear his heavy breathing of the sleep. You know, the just when you're sleeping, that is the deep breathing that is happening. And then after a while, he came up, he sat up, and he raised his head to the heavens and he said, Subhan al-Malik al-Quddus, Subhan al-Malik al-Quddus, Subhan al-Malik al-Quddus. And then he recited, Inna fi khalqi as-samawati wal-ardi wa ikhtilafi al-layli wan-nahari la-ayatin li-ulil al-bab alladhina yadhkuruna Allah qiyaman wa qu'udan wa 'ala junubihim wa yatafakkaruna fi khalqi as-samawati wal-ard rabbana ma khalaqta hadha batilan subhanaka faqina 'adhab an-nar. Subhanallah. Ibn Abbas is the one who preserves for us what the Prophet ﷺ would do in the middle of the night. If this hadn't happened, we wouldn't know. This is Allah's preservation of His religion. That the child is fighting his sleep, and because he fought his sleep, all of us benefit. The father is so eager that he sends his son to go monitor his own nephew's habits at night. This type of eagerness has preserved the religion for us. This type of enthusiasm and zeal has benefited us. Then he stood up and used the siwak and did wudu. And then he entered his place of salah and he prayed two prayers. They weren't short, but they weren't long. Middle quantity. Then he went back to sleep and I could hear his heavy breathing. Then after a while, he stood up again and he did the exact same thing as he did the first time. And he prayed two rak'ah, not too short, not too long. And then he went back to sleep again. So, and pause here. So sometimes the Prophet ﷺ would pray continuously for an hour or 2 hours. And sometimes whenever he woke up, he would pray, then go back to sleep. Whichever one suited him. So in this day, this evening, he just prayed and then he went back to sleep, prayed and then went back to sleep. Then at the end, he did one rak'ah witr. So he did this a few times. Then he did one rak'ah witr. And then I heard him say this dua. Allahumma ja'al fi basari nura, waj'al fi sam'i nura, waj'al fi lisani nura, waj'al fi qalbi nura, wa'an yamini nura, wa'an shimali nura, waj'al li min amami nura, min khalfi nura, min fawqi nura, wa min asfali nura, waj'al li yawm al-qiyamati nura, wa'a'zim li nura. We have done this hadith for those of you that attend the classes after the Isha Salah. This is the dua for nur. Oh Allah, put nur in my hearing and seeing. Am I right and left? Am I in front of me, behind me, on top of me, and beneath me? O Allah, give me light on the Day of Judgment. O Allah, perfect my light for me. So this hadith is a beautiful hadith that demonstrates that Al-Abbas radiallahu ta'ala an, even as a young child, was eager to benefit from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And subhanAllah, what 12-year-old will be able to be so eager for knowledge that he will fight sleep in order to memorize what the Prophet ﷺ is doing? Think about it. Forget 12. Us at our age, how much could we do? Okay? So we see from now who this person is going to become. If he can do this at this age, what's he going to do when he is a man? We also learn from Sahih Muslim that this wasn't the only time that Al-Abbas spent the night with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He reports, this is in Sahih Muslim, that one day I came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at the end of the night, meaning after Isha, and then I prayed tahajjud with him. And I prayed behind him, so I stood behind him to pray. But he held on to my hand when he saw me, and he pulled me next to him. He pulled me forward, and then he began to pray. When he began to pray, I took a few steps back, kind of disobeying. I went back. When the Prophet ﷺ finished, he said, what is the matter with you? I pulled you up and you still go back. I made you come next to me and you still go back. Ibn Abbas is 12 years old. What does he say? Ya Rasulullah, is it appropriate that anybody stands next to you and you are Rasulullah? 12-year-old kid, think about that. Right? How can I stand next to you and you are Rasulullah ﷺ? I have to stand a little bit behind you. Okay? And my answer pleased him and he prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, O Allah, Allahumma allimhu ta'wil wa faqihu fi ddeen. This is the famous phrase Ibn Abbas is known for. The Prophet ﷺ said this dua at least 3-4 times. O Allah, teach him understanding of the deen. Faqihu fi ddeen. Fiqh doesn't just mean knowledge of laws. Fiqh here means what? understanding and comprehension of deen. Faqih fi deen, wa'allimhu ta'wil, and teach him how to interpret the Quran. Okay, so this was a common dua that, as far as I know, was only combined for Ibn Abbas multiple times. Multiple times. And when he finished tahajjud, the Prophet said, Ibn Abbas said, when he finished tahajjud, he went to sleep until I could hear his heavy breathing. And then Bilal came to him and said, Ya Rasulallah, as-salah. This was how Bilal would wake him up for Salat al-Fajr. He would go to the door and he would say, Ya Rasulallah, as-salah. Then he would go and give the adhan. Okay, so he would first essentially ask permission or tell the Prophet or wake him up from behind the curtain. And this time Ibn Abbas was behind the curtain because it's the house of Maymuna. So he would say, Ya Rasulullah as-salah, and then he would go and give the adhan. So Ibn Abbas is saying that Bilal came and woke the Prophet ﷺ up, and then he stood up to pray and did not repeat his wudu when he prayed Fajr. Okay, this hadith is in Sahih Muslim. Now, this hadith is one of the main hadith used by pretty much all of the madhahib when they're trying to explain their different positions about wudu and sleep. Okay, believe it or not, there's like 9 opinions about this issue. I'm not exaggerating, literally. Actually, if I'm not mistaken, there's more than 9, but I mean, I know there's definitely 9 opinions about this issue. In other words, even the 4 madhahib, each one has multiple riwayat within them. Okay, we're not going to go over all of them. I think we covered this in our fiqh of wudu class many, many years ago. But all of you should remember, of course, from those days, it's all written, alhamdulillah. Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah ta'ala, basically said that if you fall asleep in a flat position lying down, then your wudu is broken. Malik said if you fall asleep for a long sleep, then your wudu is broken. A short sleep, it is not broken. The Hanbali said, a short sleep with your back to a wall and you're behind on the ground. Okay, so you have to be firmly planted. That's the word they use, by the way, not me. Okay, you have to be firmly planted on the ground, then your wudu is not broken. And the Shafi'i said that as long as you're firmly planted, even if you sleep for a long time, then your wudu is not broken. Essentially, all of the madhahib agree that wudu is not broken by the sleep. It is broken by the potential unconsciousness that will result in the breaking of wind, that will result in the breaking of wudu. Okay? You understand? Sleep in and of itself does not break the wudu according to all of the four madhahib. The issue is that obviously while one sleeps, one can break wind and that will break the wudu. So to what level of sleep will you qualify that level? That's where the madhahib differ. And Ibn Taymiyyah said, look, all of these tafasil, the hadith don't come with. Essentially, when you are fairly certain that your sleep was, whether it's because of the posture, whether it's because of it was just a light sleep, you know, just like you just literally just doze off and then you wake up. Or even if you doze off for a little bit and it was a light sleep. Generally speaking, these types of light sleep, the slightest motion or movement, it will wake up. Ibn Taymiyyah says, it's not an issue of your posture or the length or whatnot. It's an issue of common sense. If it was a deep sleep where you lost, you have no clue what happened, then your wudu is broken. And if you feel that your sleep was not of that level, then you should continue in your wudu. And in any way, that was just a side point. But all of the madahib base it on this hadith as well, because they all read in their positions, because the hadith is vague. Doesn't say what. So they all read in their positions. The Hanbali say he must have been sitting down. And the Shafi'i say this. And each one says their own. In the end of the day, it doesn't say any of that. And Ibn Taymiyyah says, you're bringing in conditions that are not mentioned in the hadith. In any case, back to Ibn Abbas. Would volunteer his services for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and help him out, do khidmah, yani prepare stuff for him, help him out in the house. And it is because of this and other reasons that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam paid special attention to him and made dua for him. In Musnad Imam Ahmad, it says that one day the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in the house of Maymuna, my aunt Maymuna. So I prepared his wudu container for him so that he would have it at night. And Maymuna said, O Messenger of Allah, my nephew Ibn Abbas prepared this water for you. So the Prophet ﷺ once again made dua for him that Allahumma faqihu fi din wa allimhu ta'wil. And in another narration, he says that once the Prophet ﷺ went to the restroom, and so I prepared his water for him when he came back. Okay, so essentially, you know, you can imagine that the water container would have been a massive container, and there's going to be a smaller container that you need to do your affairs with it. So Abdullah ibn Abbas would basically get the smaller pot and make it ready and put it wherever would be the place where the Prophet would wash his hands and do wudu. So all of these, Ibn Abbas is narrating, and the Prophet has made dua for him during these times. In one of the most powerful narrations as well, we see, and this hadith is one of the most famous hadith, so famous that Imam An-Nawawi put it in his 40 hadith, and these 40 hadith are essentially the most famous hadith of Islam. And Ibn Rajab Al-Hanbali wrote an entire booklet. Ibn Rajab is famous for writing like around 30 or 40 booklets on different hadith. Each booklet is a different hadith. So he chose some very amazing hadith and he wrote booklets on them. So this is one of those hadith he wrote an entire treatise on. And it is a famous hadith. We all are familiar with it. And I'm just going to quote it to you from Musnad Imam Ahmad, the Musnad of Abdullah ibn Abbas. Abdullah ibn Abbas narrated that one day I rode on the same mount as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, on the same mount, whether it was a camel, whether it was a horse, whether it was a donkey, it's not mentioned in this hadith. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to me, Ya ghulam, inni u'allimuka kalimat. O young boy, I'm going to teach you some wisdom, some phrases, some knowledge. I'm going to teach you some knowledge. And this is of the most beautiful ahadith. Many books have been written. I gave an entire khutbah about this 3-4 years ago as well on this very hadith. احفظ الله يحفظك. Guard Allah, Allah will guard you. Protect Allah, Allah will protect you. احفظ الله تجده تجاهك. Guard Allah, protect Allah, and you will find Allah in front of you. إذا سألت فاسأل الله. If you ask, don't ask anybody except Allah. وَإِذَا اسْتَعَنْتَ فَاسْتَعِنْ بِاللَّهِ. If you ask any help, don't ask anybody except Allah. وَاعْلَمْ أَنَّ الْأُمَّةَ لَوْ اجْتَمَعُوا عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَنْفَعُوكَ بِشَيْءٍ. And know that if the whole ummah came to benefit you, لَمْ يَنْفَعُوكَ بِشَيْءٍ إِلَّا قَدْ كَتَبَهُ اللَّهُ لَكَ. They're not going to be able to benefit you except with something Allah has already predetermined for you. And if they came to harm you, they would not harm you except if Allah has already predestined it for you. رفعت الأقلام وجفت الصحف. The pens have been raised and the ink has dried, or the paper has dried from what has been written. رفعت الأقلام وجفت الصحف. This beautiful narration is one of the most famous narrations of hadith, and many hadith have been given. Of course, many lectures have been given. Of course, it's so beautiful because it talks about muraqaba, or thinking of Allah, the concept of ihsan, a belief in qadr, tawakkul in Allah, putting your complete yaqeen and dua upon Allah. So many different parameters are in this hadith, and that's why it's such a popular hadith. The point here, the Prophet ﷺ is telling Ibn Abbas directly, oh young boy, I'm going to teach you some wisdom. And he taught him this beautiful hadith. Ibn Kathir also narrates another interesting narration. Once Abbas and Ibn Abbas visited the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they entered in upon him, but he did not turn around to greet them. And Abbas became perturbed and disturbed, and when he didn't respond, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not respond, they left. And Abbas said to his son, didn't you see your cousin not paying any attention to us? Meaning, what's the matter? Why isn't he responding? And Ibn Abbas said, but he had a visitor, he was speaking to him, that's why he didn't respond to us. Couldn't you see there was a guest? And he's ignoring us because of that. And Abbas said, what? You saw another person? I didn't see any other person. So the next day, Abbas visited the Prophet and said that we came yesterday and you didn't seem to notice us. But then my son Ibn Abdullah said that he saw you with another person. Did you have a guest? And the Prophet said to Abdullah, did you see the guest? Did you see the visitor? And Abdullah Ibn Abbas said, yes. So he said, that is Jibreel. So you saw Jibreel, that is Jibreel, and eventually your eyesight will be taken away from you. It's a prediction based upon what has happened. Now, why is this the case? Allah knows best what is the relationship. But the Prophet ﷺ predicted that eventually your eyesight will be taken away from you. And towards the very end of Ibn Abbas's life, when he was in his 70s, he went blind, which was common at that time. What is it, glaucoma, whatever it is, it was common at that time. The cataracts or whatever, it was a very common thing for at that time for people to go blind towards the end of their life. So the last 2 years or something of Ibn Abbas's life, he did not have any sight. Ibn Abbas himself narrates how he began this path of knowledge. He says, when the Prophet ﷺ passed away, I said to one of the people of the Ansar, one of his friends, one of his people he would play with, Ta'al, halumma, let's go. Let's go ask the Sahaba about knowledge. For today, there are many of them. We have plenty of variety. But my sahib, my friend, my companion said, you're a strange man, Ibn Abbas. You're a strange person, Abdullah Ibn Abbas. Do you think anybody will need your knowledge by asking these questions? Meaning, what's the point of asking what everybody knows about? There are great Sahaba alive. You're asking them information. They already know it. Why would you want to get that information? Why would you want to attain that knowledge? And all of these great giants are here. What's the purpose of studying? So Ibn Abbas said, فَتَرَكْتُهُ. I left him. Khalas, leave him. And أَقْبَلْتُ. I turned to the Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I began asking and studying. And it would happen that sometimes I would hear that so and so heard a hadith, so I would go to his house only to find him taking a nap or sleeping in the daytime. So I would take my cloak, put it outside the ground, sit down outside his house, and the wind would blow in my face, the dust would come in my hair, and I would wait for him to come out and I would ask him the question. And he would say to me, Yabna Ammi Rasulullah, O cousin of the Prophet ﷺ, what are you doing here? And Ibn Abbas would say, I came to ask a question. And he would say, but you should have sent somebody, I will come to you. Meaning you are the cousin of the Prophet, I will come to you. And Ibn Abbas would respond, no, it is more appropriate that I come to you. And then I would ask him about that hadith. Time went on until one day that companion of mine saw me and I was surrounded by all of those students. So now he's an older man, okay? And his sahib of the Ansar, he saw him, and his companion said, surely that young boy was smarter than I was. Okay, he did what invested in his time, and now it paid off for him in this world and the next. And of course, it's obvious, we see here the benefits of long-term planning. It's obvious. I mean, that's why we study so hard. You know, when we're in our 20s, or, you know, we're supposed to study hard, you know, going to college and high school and whatnot, so that inshallah ta'ala, we then have a career, we can have an education, we then, this is what Ibn Abbas is doing. He's studying hard so that it then pays off in this world and the next. And what better way to study than in the religion of Islam? It also shows us an eagerness for knowledge. That subhanAllah, there's a thirst, an unquestionable, just a desire to study, to ask every intricacy. And subhanAllah, not everybody who goes to study Islam has a thirst for studying Islam. I can tell you this from my own experiences, 10 years in the seminary system that I was in. The majority of people, astaghfirullah, but they might not come for the right reasons. And they're just coming for superficial reasons or whatever. They don't have a thirst, just an unsatiated desire to just absorb everything. It's those students who shine. As for the one who just barely ekes out, gets a C on the exam, just passes, they become nobodies. They're nothing. There's nothing, no, nothing happens to them. It's the people that are following the footsteps of Ibn Abbas. And that earnest desire, it's a gift from Allah. You cannot put it into a child's head. You cannot force it into a teenager or a young man. It's a gift from Allah that Ibn Abbas had it, and he wanted to ask and ask and ask and ask, and he's never satisfied, always studying. You cannot create somebody like Allah Azza wa Jal gives it. This also shows us the respect that one should have for knowledge and studying and teachers and the people of knowledge. Despite the fact that Ibn Abbas is Ahlul Bayt, and so an older Sahabi says, why are you coming to me? I'll come to you. You're younger. Doesn't matter. You're Ahlul Bayt. You are the cousin. And this also serves us, by the way, the respect of Ahlul Bayt. It's a two-way street, right? Ibn Abbas is respecting his teachers. His teachers are respecting Ahlul Bayt. And this is how the early Sahaba were. So Ibn Abbas is respecting his teachers. And when you show respect to those who deserve it, Allah Azza wa Jal will create people who will then show you respect when you deserve it. When you give respect when it is due, it will be given to you when it is due. So when Abdullah ibn Abbas humbled himself for knowledge, Allah Azza wa Jal raised him up so that everybody humbled themselves at his feet. This is, as the Arabic saying goes, كَمَا تَدِينُ تُدَانُ. As you do unto others, it will be done unto you. This also shows us the difficulties of studying. It's not easy to study any subject. And all of you are, mashallah, educated, doctors, engineers, whatever. It's not easy to study. And Islamic sciences, wallahi, they are even more difficult for multiple reasons. Multiple reasons. Of them is the complexity. You don't have the luxury of just taking one field. You have to master all the disciplines of Islam. From Nahu to Aqidah to Tafsir, you have to do everything at least at some level. And of them, and many reasons for this, of them is the weightiness of the knowledge itself. And it's not easy. Here we have Ibn Abbas spending decades doing this. And of course, of the benefits of this very beautiful narration, the impediments of studying need to be gotten rid of. His friend was telling him, don't study. Ibn Abbas said, I left him. That's what you have to do. You cannot allow negative influences to influence you negatively. When there are people that are pulling you back, when there are people that are preventing you, you have to do. Just cut off and move on. That's what Ibn Abbas did. Fatraktu, I left him. I can't be bothered by somebody who's not going to help me in good. And that is a very brave thing for a teenager. Because how old was he? 14 years old when the Prophet passes away. At the age of 14, and he wants to go and sit outside the houses of the Sahaba. He does not want to go play. He does not want to go do other things that 14-year-olds do. He wants to sit outside the house of the Sahaba to gain knowledge. He also said, and all of this is when he's much older now, and he's benefiting his students from his own teaching and his own method. He also said, it was not uncommon that I would ask the same question to 30 of the Sahaba to get different answers. 30 Sahaba asking the same question. Why? Because everybody has a different benefit and wisdom. And I speak from experience as well, and every student of knowledge speaks from experience. Even though you think you might have done research, when you go to the specialists and the experts, they will point out things you did not know. And the more experts you go to, the more your horizon broadens. During the time of Umar ibn al-Khattab as the Khalifa, of course, this is when Ibn Abbas now essentially becomes a young man. So when Umar becomes a Khalifa, he's 16 years old. Umar's a Khalifa for 10 years. So from 16 to 26, now he comes of age. He becomes a full-fledged young man. Umar radiallahu anh had a khas shura council. He had an inner circle that they would meet every so often. Composed of the people of Badr, the senior Sahaba, he would invite Ibn Abbas to that council. Once one of the people on the council objected, and they said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, how come you invite this young lad, and we have sons, even older than him, you don't invite them? How come our children are not invited, and Ibn Abbas is invited? And at that point, Umar said, right now he said, Wayhak, woe to you, don't you know who he is? Meaning he is the cousin of the Prophet ﷺ. Don't you know who he is? Not like any other one of your sons, he is the cousin of the Prophet ﷺ. Then Abdullah ibn Abbas said, I got a call one day, meaning a messenger came, that Amir al-Mu'mineen is calling you for a council. And I thought that he wants to show the others why I'm in the gathering. It's a special thing happening, right? So he comes to the council, and Umar radiallahu anh recites Surah Al-Nasr, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ. This is a hadith, this is in Bukhari, it's a famous hadith. إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجًا فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرْهُ إِنَّكَ كَانَ تَوَّابًا. Umar said to the Sahaba, what is the tafsir of this ayah? What is the tafsir of this surah? Some Sahaba were silent. Others said, Allah is saying that when Allah blesses you with victory, you should thank Allah. Umar turned to Ibn Abbas and said, and what do you say, O young boy? And Ibn Abbas said, I don't agree with this. So Umar said, what is your interpretation? Ibn Abbas says, this surah was meant to inform the Prophet ﷺ that he's about to die. the surah, Allah Azza wa Jal is telling him that your time, your ajal is over. It's about to finish up. And so when the Nasr of Allah and the conquest of Mecca will take place, when the victory comes with people embracing Islam, then be prepared to meet Allah and increase your tasbih and increase your istighfar before you leave this world. And Umar ibn al-Khattab said, and this is exactly what I as well know of this surah. Then he turned to the others and he said, so will you now criticize me for bringing this young man who was able to respond even though his hair is still completely black? Meaning, still young. None of you are, all of you are old. He's the youngest. Now are you going to stop criticizing me for bringing him and not your own sons when even you could not answer these questions? So here we notice that Ibn Abbas already is showing his speciality. And his speciality is tafsir. His speciality is tafsir. And it is also narrated that whenever Umar faced a very difficult judgment, qada, he would call upon Ibn Abbas to give him advice about that judgment. And it is not known that Umar radiallahu anhu called anybody else when he was in a difficult judgment situation other than Abdullah ibn Abbas. Despite the fact, once again, the age difference is around 40 years. So again, Ibn Abbas is being given a very prestigious position for the difficult cases. Umar ibn Khattab, and he is who he is in his fiqh and his ilm, he would call Ibn Abbas for his mashwara to give him advice about these difficult cases. In the time of Uthman ibn Affan, not much is narrated that I could find about Abdullah ibn Abbas, but what we do know is that in the 35th year of the Hijrah, when Uthman ibn Affan was the beginnings of the fitna began and he was trapped in his house, so he sent Abdullah ibn Abbas as the leader of the Hujjaj. This is a very prestigious position, and you are essentially the temporary governor of the Hujjaj. Imagine the minister of Hajj affairs, let's say. You have to manage all of the Hujjaj coming in from across the Muslim world. It was a position every year is given to somebody. So the final year of Uthman ibn Affan, it was given to Abdullah ibn Abbas. And everybody who participated in that Hajj praised the fiqh and the wisdom of Ibn Abbas. In fact, it was so happened that if you remember, our mothers, the mothers of the believers, they participated in Hajj after a long time that year. And they participated under Ibn Abbas. And they remarked that none of the previous Hujjaj had followed the Prophet as exactly as Ibn Abbas had done. It's following him exactly what he did, Ibn Abbas would do. And he gave the khutbah in Arafat, and it was a tafsir of Surah An-Nur. That was his khutbah, tafsir of Surah An-Nur. And the people who attended, there's a famous phrase that is mentioned in so many books of Quran and tafsir al-Ulum al-Quran. The people who attended, they said that if the Turks and the Persians and the Daylamites were like people in the Caucasians, if they had attended, they would have all accepted Islam, listening to the wisdom of Ibn Abbas. So he gave a beautiful khutbah that was so profound and moving that the people said, if non-Muslims had attended, they would have all embraced Islam. And during the time of Ali radiallahu ta'ala an, Ali asked Ibn Abbas to become the governor of Dimashq, of Damascus. But Ibn Abbas politely refused and said, no, leave it in the hands of Muawiyah. It seems Ibn Abbas understood that if he went, he would be in trouble. The people of Damascus already loved Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan because he had been placed there since the time of, who remembers? Umar ibn Khattab. He had been there for 20 years now, or 18 years. And so it is as if Ibn Abbas understood, there's going to be a problem if I go. Don't send me there. So Ali then sent him to Basra. And so it was the only official governorship that he had for 2.5 years, that he was the governor of Basra for a short period of time. This is the only political office he held. And then after this, he didn't hold a single political office, as we're going to mention now. So he became the governor of Basra, and the people of other provinces began to feel jealous of the people of Basra because they had such a great leader and a great governor, and Basra hardly gave any problems. The problems came from Kufa and from Damascus. Basra did not really give any problems. That was where Ibn Abbas was the governor. And Ibn Abbas was the governor of Basra when Ali radiallahu anhu came to Basra before the battle of Siffin. And he was on the side of Ali in the battle of Siffin. So he did participate in the battle of Siffin because he was the governor of Ali ibn Abi Talib. And when the Kharijites split away, you remember the Kharijites split away, we talked about this, when the Kharijites split away from the group of Ali radiallahu anhu, he was the one who told Ali radiallahu anhu that, allow me to go and debate with them. From Basra, they had camped at a place called Harura. Outside of Basra, they had camped at a place. And Ibn Abbas, being the governor and being the cousin of the Prophet ﷺ, he said, let me go debate with them. And this debate is one of the most earliest, one of the most famous, one of the most profound debates of early Islam. Much commentary has been given about it. One second, we're going to go to one of our source books, Sunan al-Bayhaqi, which is also one of the classical books of early Islam. And Imam al-Bayhaqi in his Sunan, he mentions the story in quite a lot of detail. We're not going to mention every single phrase of it. But to quickly summarize what happened. So when the Haruriya, they were called, the Sahaba did not call them Khawarij. The Sahaba called them Haruriya because they had camped at Harura. So they called them the Haruriya. When the Haruriya left the camp of Ali, they were 6,000 strong. So this is Ibn Abbas saying, I went to Ali radiallahu anh and I said, O Amir al-Mu'mineen, O Amir al-Mu'mineen, allow me to go and speak with them. Ali radiallahu anh said, Inni akhafu alayk, I'm scared they might harm you. I'm scared they might harm you. And Ibn Abbas said, no, they will not harm me. They will not harm me. So I was given permission. So I then wore my best clothes that I possessed. And I wore a Yemeni cloak. And I went to them when they had gathered in their houses for the afternoon nap. Meaning, he went at a time where there was minimal activity. It was the custom of the Arabs to have a qaylula. Qaylula, after dhuhr, or some said before dhuhr. And essentially when the sun is hot, they're going to take a rest, a nap. Ibn Abbas entered their camp at that time. Nobody's going to fight when the sun is that hot. Nobody's going to do anything at that time. So again, this is from the fiqh of Ibn Abbas. So he entered in upon them and said, it's the first person. And I said salam to them. And they said, marhaban bika ya Aba Abbas. Ibn Abbas's kunya was Abul Abbas as well, because his son was Abbas. Abbas ibn Abdullah ibn Abbas. So his eldest was Al-Abbas. So his kunya is Abul Abbas. Okay, a lot of Abbas is here. But anyway, you get the point. Marhaban, ya Aba Abbas. One of them said, what type of fine garments are you wearing? How can you wear these clothes? So Ibn Abbas said, how can you criticize me when I saw the Prophet ﷺ wear something better than this? And how can you criticize me when Allah says in the Quran, قُلْ مَنْ حَرَّمَ زِينَةَ اللَّهِ الَّتِي أَخْرَجَ لِعِبَادِهِ وَطَيَّبَاتِهِ How, who has forbidden, Allah is saying in the Quran, who has forbidden the beautiful clothes that I have created for my servants? And who has forbidden the good food that I have given them? Who can make it haram, Allah is saying. So Ibn Abbas is already showing them, you have no knowledge, you're just a bunch of overzealous fanatics, and wallahi, we still have these Kharijites to this day. A bunch of ignoramus, overzealous fanatics. They just, again, I mean, we deal with them, I deal with them all the time on Facebook and whatnot. These people are all, this is their version of Islam. So it's nothing new. So Ibn Abbas says, the Prophet in the Quran, very clear. So one of them said, why have you come to us? So he said, I came to you from the Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, from the Muhajirun and from the Ansar. In other words, I'm coming to you from the camp of knowledge, from the camp of the Sahaba. And I want to ask you why you are doing what you are doing. Do you not realize that the people you are fighting are those who witnessed the revelation of the Quran? They accompanied the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They were with him. In other words, who are you and who are they? Who exactly are you? And who exactly are they? And Ibn Abbas said that they are more knowledgeable of the Quran than you. And in fact, there is not a single person amongst you who even saw the Prophet ﷺ, much less saw the Quran come down. So Ibn Abbas first uses what is called the term for this in logic is argument from authority, which is a valid argument when there is genuine authority from one side and no authority from the other. In other words, if you're not a mathematician, who exactly are you to derive mathematical principles? If you're not a doctor, don't criticize what doctors are doing. Who exactly are you? There is a valid point to be made here. Okay, so Ibn Abbas is saying, I have come to you from the Muhajirun, the Ansar, those who fought with the Prophet, and they saw the Quran being revealed. Who better to understand it than them? And who exactly are you? Where did you get your knowledge from? Did you see the... Not one of the 6,000 was Sahaba. Think about that. Not one of them had seen the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they said, one of them said, don't argue with him, for he is from the Quraysh. And Allah has criticized the Quraysh in the Quran by saying, Balhum qawmun khasimun. They are a group that always argue. SubhanAllah, what utter foolishness. What utter foolishness. Who else is from the Quraysh? The Prophet ﷺ. This ayah came down upon the likes of Amr ibn al-As. Al-As ibn Wa'lan, Al-As ibn his father. Umayyah ibn Khalaf, Abu Jahl. And Allah says to them, they're just arguing without any knowledge. And one of the signs of the Khawarij, they take verses that were meant for the pagans and they apply them for the Muslims. So they took this verse that was meant for the likes of Abu Jahl and they applied it for the likes of Ibn Abbas. How utter foolish. Others said that, what is the problem? Let him speak. Let us hear what he has to say. And so they eventually agreed to speaking with him. So Ibn Abbas said, what do you criticize the cousin of the Prophet ﷺ, Ali ibn Abi Talib, for? What do you criticize his son-in-law for? What do you criticize all of the Muhajirin and Ansar for? What is your argument? So they said, we have three things. We have three arguments, three criticisms. Number one, they said, that they took the judgment of men instead of the judgment of Allah. And Allah says, in al-hukmu illa lillah. Judgment only belongs to Allah. And men should have no say in judgment. Ibn Abbas said, okay, this is one. What is the next one? So the second one they said, when Ali radiallahu anhu fought, he did not take ghanima. Remember, they were in the army of Ali. Remember, they were in the army of Ali. He did not take ghanima. He did not distribute the spoils of war. He did not follow the rules that we're all accustomed to. So, if the people he fought were kuffar, why didn't we get their ghanima? And if the people we fought were Muslims, then we weren't able to fight them in the first place. You get the point here. Either this or that. Okay? So, Ibn Abbas said, okay, this is number two. What is number three? So, they said, number three was that when he was in that debate with, when the they had agreed to a debate, Muawiyah's representative and Ali's representative, Ali radiallahu an agreed to step down from the title of Amir al-Mu'mineen. He stepped down from this title and he didn't claim Amir al-Mu'mineen. So if he's not Amir al-Mu'mineen, then he must be Amir al-Kafirin. See, this type of mentality, I swear we still have it to this day. This black and white mentality, okay? And again, I have unfortunately plenty of experience because I have to deal with these people online all the time. It is unbelievable, but there's still these overzealous, fanatical youth out there. They literally view the world in this extreme black and white. And you're either with us or you're a kafir. This is what they're saying to Ali. You're either Amir al-Mu'minin or you're Amir al-Kafirin. There's nothing in the middle. So Ibn Abbas said, do you have anything other than these? They said, no, this is enough, these three. Then Ibn Abbas said, and I saw them, looking around them, and he describes, I'm going to summarize, it's a very long thing, that they seem to have outward markings of piety. They were deep marks of sajda on their forehead. They were the hear the buzzing of bees like reciting the Quran. Like there's Quran being recited everywhere and you can hear the buzzing of bees in the camp, meaning it's reciting Quran, right? They were wearing the coarsest of garments. They're not interested in the dunya. So outwardly they have these elements that seem to be pious. And inwardly they are the most bloodthirsty, fanatical, crazy people on the face of this earth. Does that ring a bell in our times? Okay. You look at them and you listen 2-3 minutes, you're like, okay, that actually makes sense. Okay, that's strong iman, this and that. Then you see what they do. And you're like, this is not Islam. This is exactly early Kharijites. Exactly. Ibn Abbas is impressed at their outward piety. Can you imagine? Ibn Abbas is impressed at their outward piety. But of course, that outward piety is only a veneer. Inside of it is nothing, an empty shell, hollow, nothing. So, Ibn Abbas said, if I explain to you these 3 points, will you be satisfied? Yes. Will you come back? Yes, we will come back. Okay. And then he goes one after the other. I'm going to summarize this. So, their first point, they said that judgment belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this verse is a very deep and profound verse. And really, all of the jihadist movements have used this verse as one of their main verses against the rest of the ummah. In al-hukmu illa lillah. Ironically, they take the same verse of the Kharijites. We also believe in this verse. We also believe in it. But to take this verse and make blanket takfir, excommunication of the majority of the ummah, this is what the Kharijites did. And it's very obvious how they do. Okay, so this government is not applying the Sharia, so the government is kafir. So the president is kafir. So the prime minister is kafir. So the ministers are kafir because they are judging by other than the law of Allah. Then not just the ministers, the secretaries working for the minister is kafir. Not just that, the driver who's driving the minister is kafir. The cook who's cooking food for the minister is kafir. Not just that, but now the people who are supplying the infrastructure are also kafir. And who's supplying the infrastructure? Everybody. Everybody in the entire, you know, world. And so everybody is a kafir except for our little group. That's exactly what the early Kharijites did. And wallahi, this is exactly what ISIS does to this day. Exactly what it does to this day. If you are not on our methodology, automatically you are a kafir, halal ad-dam. We will kill you by any and every means possible. And this is the reality of this group as it was of this group. So Ibn Abbas basically says, so here's the point. Judgment belongs to Allah. This does not mean that every fatwa will come directly from Allah. That's ridiculous. That's ridiculous. Men have to be intermediaries. Men have to take the Quran and Sunnah and extract what is the intent of the Quran and Sunnah for this situation. Okay? And in fact, beautiful, not here, I'm going into my tangents here, but the first Kharijites, before they left Ali radiallahu anhu, Ali radiallahu called them to the masjid. And remember, they had raised the Quran and they said, we want the Quran to judge. And the other said, also, we want the Quran to judge. So we want the Quran to judge. So Ali radiallahu anhu brought the Quran into the room in front of them. And he then shouted to the Quran, okay, Quran, judge us. The response is silence. Ali says, Quran, judge. It's silence. Why aren't you judging? Then one of them said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, the Quran's not going to speak back to you. And that's when I said, you fool, that's exactly what I'm trying to get across to you. The Quran is not going to speak to you about your particular situation. You need an alim, a mufti, a qadi, a judge. You need a faqih to read the Quran, use ijtihad, right? Know the hadith, know the halal haram, and then apply the fatwa based upon what Allah and His Messenger have said. That's not rejecting Allah's hukum. That is how you implement Allah's hukum. So essentially, Ibn Abbas proved them wrong in this manner, because Allah says in the Quran that when a man and a woman are having a dispute, their marriage is in trouble and whatnot. So Allah says, let her choose an arbitrator, let him choose an arbitrator, and let the arbitrators decide. Ibn Abbas said, oh, you fools, do you think that we need arbitrators to solve a marriage and we're not allowed arbitrators to solve the problems of the ummah? Which is more important? Because remember, Ali and Muawiyah had arbitrators, right? And Ibn Abbas said, if Allah wants arbitrator for something as a personal marriage, how about something as great as the Ummah? Can't we get arbitrators to solve the problems of the Ummah? So he refuted the first point. So they said, okay, we understand. What's the second one? So, what was the second point? What was their second? Who can remember? You remember the 3 points? The ghanima. The ghanima. So, Ibn Abbas says that you wanted to take ghanima when you fought the battle of the Jamal? Do you not realize you were fighting your mother? Who amongst you would have dared to take your mother as ghanima? Have you lost comprehension? And as for your claim that if we fight them, they are either Muslim or they're kafir, haven't you read what Allah says in Surah Hujurat? وَإِنْ طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ قَتَتَلُوا فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا فَإِنْ بَغَتْ إِحْدَاهُمَا عَلَى الْأُخْرَى فَقَاتِلُوا الَّتِي تَبْغِي حَتَّى تَفِيءَ الْأَمْرِ اللَّهِ. If two groups of Muslims fight one another, so Allah called them Muslims even though they were fighting one another. It's explicit in the Quran. This is what you call Ibn Abbas's genius. He can just, it's as if the Quran is in front of him, the hadith is in front of him. He can just pick and choose and he can give the evidence he needs. It's explicit in the Quran. If two groups of mu'mins are fighting each other, so Allah calls both of them mu'min and they're fighting. It's not black and white like the Kharijites believe. It's not that simple. They were believers, but there's a political issue going on, and that doesn't mean one of them is kafir, one of them is a believer. And then, as for the third point, he said that you are objecting to Ali radiallahu anh not using his title Amir al-Mu'mineen, and our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, when Suhail ibn Amr came, he gave up the title Rasulullah on that piece of paper, and he didn't put it there. So who has more right to give up their titles? So if he could do it, why couldn't the cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam do it? And so when he won the debate, clearly, hands down, 2/3 of the Kharijites actually returned. So 4,000 of them returned. 4,000 of them returned, and 2,000 did not go back. So this, again, we get to, again, one of the main stories of Ibn Abbas's time. Inshallah, let's try to finish this up, because I don't want to go for port number 4. Inshallah, we'll finish up the story of Ibn Abbas now. So this is in the Battle of Siffin. After the Battle of Siffin, he negotiated between the Kharijites. Ali radiallahu anhu, as you know, was assassinated, and Muawiyah was declared the Khalifa. And so Ibn Abbas retired to Medina. He wanted to just get away from politics now. He wanted to live a quiet life. And he did not get involved in siyasa till the day that he died. So Abdullah ibn Abbas now made it a characteristic for the rest of his life, for the rest of the next 30 years he was on this earth, he remained completely apolitical. So much so that his apolitical stances got problematic for him. Because the problem comes, people want you to become political sometimes. And Ibn Abbas refused to. And this got him into trouble. Muawiyah tried to, didn't work. And Hussein radiallahu anhu wanted him to join his party when he went to Kufa. Okay? And remember, we went the story in detail of Hussein. And Ibn Abbas was the senior most Ahlul Bayt alive. He was the eldest Ahlul Bayt alive. By senior, I don't mean in terms of blood, because Hussein is higher in blood. He's the grandson. In terms of blood relationship, Hussein is higher. But in terms of age, Ibn Abbas is older. And Ibn Abbas begged Hussein radiallahu anhu, literally by holding on to him, begged him before leaving the city, do not leave Medina. Don't trust your partisans. Do not trust those partisans of Iraq, because they will stab you in the back. And Hussein had already made up his mind, and so what happened happened, and Ibn Abbas did not want it to happen. He was trying his best to pull him back. And Yazid, of course, eventually became the Khalifa, as you know, that happened. When Yazid died, there were problems in the Umayyad dynasty, who's going to take over next. And it was that point in time that Abdullah ibn Zubayr in Makkah declared himself to be the Khalifa as well. Okay, it was a time of great chaos and great problems. And Abdullah ibn Zubayr declared himself to be a Khalifa and in Mecca and Medina and across the Hijaz, he was essentially in control. And Ibn Abbas was living in the Hijaz. And so Ibn Zubayr insisted. Ibn Abbas is now 768 years old. Almost a few years left to him to live. He doesn't know me, obviously. He's old at this time point in time. And Ibn Zubayr insists, you must give me the bay'ah. And Ibn Abbas says, no, I don't want to give you or the other guy. I don't want to get involved. Why? Because he is too big of a personality to get involved. He's not like some nobody on the street. For him to get involved is taking a stand clearly. And in this issue, it's too great to take a stand. He doesn't want to get involved on either side. And he promises Ibn Zubayr, Abdullah Ibn Zubayr, I'm not going to give bay'ah to the other guy, just let me be. Unfortunately, it seems that Abdullah Ibn Zubayr was not satisfied with this. And I can understand, you can understand why. Abdullah Ibn Abbas is a huge pawn in this game. You understand what I'm saying? Like, I'm not trying to be derogatory to use the word pawn, but he is a very famous figure. Both sides want him. He is the senior most Sahabi alive at this point in time. And he is the cousin of the Prophet ﷺ. How can you not be eager to have him on your side? And Ibn Abbas does not want, he's already, you know, been through 20 years of civil war. He does not want anything else. He just wants to live his life. And unfortunately, tensions were created between this and Abdullah ibn Zubayr because of all of these incidents. And, you know, things get worse because Ibn Abbas disagrees with Abdullah ibn Zubayr on many issues. Abdullah ibn Zubayr wanted to demolish the Kaaba because the Kaaba had been destroyed or damaged by the catapults. This is so shocking. Muslims hear about this, like, what are you talking about? I'm sorry to tell you this, I've said this many times. We have some really, really sordid incidents in early Islamic history. The heart bleeds. And it's very sad to hear these stories. The Kaaba was attacked, not by pagans, not by external people. The Kaaba was attacked by the orders of the Khalifa of the time, under Hajjaj ibn Yusuf, but by the orders of the Khalifa. So does not, the buck stops up there. Hajjaj is the governor, but he got permission to do it. Okay? And Hajjaj attacked in order to get Ibn Zubayr dislodged and get rid of him. And he attacked the holiest of holy cities, and he used catapults against the city. And if you're going to use catapults and you're attacking Mecca, what's going to happen? One of them landed on the Kaaba. And it damaged the Kaaba. So once Ibn Zubayr repels them back and he gains victory again, it was a battle. You know, 20 years, Ibn Zubayr, not 20, but almost. Ibn Zubayr is battling with the Umayyads for so long. And in fact, many of the early scholars considered Abdullah ibn Zubayr to be the Khalifa and the Umayyads to be the usurpers at this point in time. Who was the real Khalifa? Some madhab say this, some madhab say that. Anyway, who cares at this time? It's a bit too late now. So Ibn Abbas said, don't demolish the Kaaba, just make the repairs. Don't get rid of it and build it again, or else you're going to make the Kaaba a plaything. Don't do that. Ibn Zubayr disregarded this, and he rebuilt the Kaaba. Who remembers how? Rectangle, why? Why did he rebuild the Kaaba as a rectangle? Who had run out of wood? The Quraysh. In what year? How old was the Prophet? This one, this people should know. Yes, so this is going back how old? When the Prophet is in his 30s, 35 years old. 35. Before the Ba'tha by a few years. This is when Ja'al Amin, Ja'al Sadiq, when they became happy. When they saw him come in, when the sheet was raised with the, this is that incident, right? So this is now going back almost a century. They built the Kaaba as a square because they didn't have wood to build as a rectangle. So the Prophet ﷺ said, famous hadith in Sahih Bukhari, he said, O Aisha, if I were able to, and if your people weren't such brand new Muslims, I would have destroyed this building and made it upon the original foundations of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Abdullah ibn Zubayr knew this hadith. So he said, okay, I'm going to do it. So he demolished that structure and he rebuilt for the only time in Islamic history, there was a square Kaaba for 10 years. The only time in Islamic history. So the Hijr, you know, that semicircle, was included inside the Kaaba. Okay, so it became a square. And Ibn Abbas told him, don't do this. You're going to make, you know, it's going to, he realized that as soon as you lose, what's going to happen? He realized the Kaaba is going to become, and that's exactly what happened. When they finally captured Ibn Zubayr, and one of the most gruesome things took place, and I'm sorry to even say this to you, but they crucified him in front of the Kaaba. I mean, again, this is our own history. You know, this is what the reality that we lived in. So they massacred and they killed him. Hajjaj eventually recaptured the Kaaba and whatnot. And the first thing he does is what? Destroy the Kaaba, because he doesn't want any legacy left of Abdullah ibn Zubayr. Okay? By the way, there is a museum in Mecca of the Kaaba. There's a museum in Mecca. When next time you go for Umrah, make sure you visit that museum. And you will find in it one of the original columns of Abdullah ibn Zubayr. It's an amazing thing that they still have to this day. One of the original columns of Abdullah ibn Zubayr. And I have it on my Snapchat when I did it. And also on YouTube, I think somebody put it on there. One of the original columns of Abdullah ibn Zubayr. It is preserved to this day. In any case, so tensions continue to rise. Things happen, it's best not to mention them in detail. And Ibn Abbas was forced to leave Mecca. It's too much pressure. Ibn Abbas was forced to leave Mecca, and so he goes to the close by city of Ta'if. And barely a few days or weeks after this, he passes away at the age of 72 or 73, and he is buried to this day in the city of Ta'if, and it is called Masjid Ibn Abbas. I have prayed there. We have seen the grave of Ibn Abbas. It's well known to this day. It is a famous place where he passed away and died. It is reported in Ibn Sa'd, a beautiful story, that when his sons and grandsons lifted his janazah to put him in the grave, a white pigeon appeared out of the heavens and entered into his coffin. And they tried to find it and they could not find anything. So they took this as a positive sign from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is just a blessing from Allah. And so they interpreted it as a positive sign. In any case, so Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala an lived his life not just studying from the Prophet ﷺ, but from Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, from all of the senior Sahaba. He was a young Sahabi who absorbed all of the knowledge of the senior Sahaba along with the Prophet ﷺ, along with being his cousin and Ahlul Bayt. Nobody else is like this. And so he reached a level of ilm and fiqh and ibadah that really, at his generation, none of the other scholars had. We'll conclude Ibn Abbas by quoting one of his most famous students, Tawus. Ibn Abbas had many famous students, Mujahid and Tawus and Ikrimah. These are all students of Ibn Abbas, famous names of the Tabi'un. Tawus was asked by one of his students, "You lived at a time when there were so many senior Sahaba. Why did you abandon those and study with Ibn Abbas?" So Tawus said, "I saw 70 of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. When they differed about something, they would go and ask Ibn Abbas his opinion. So why would I not go to him as well?" So this is Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. And inshallah with that we come to the end of the biography of Abdullah ibn Abbas. I will not do a hadith from Ibn Abbas because we don't have time to do 1,660 hadith. This is volume 4 and volume 5 and I think also a bit of volume 6. All of it is Ibn Abbas. I don't think we have time to do all of this. So I will simply not do any hadith of Ibn Abbas because he's one of those who narrated so many hadith. And inshallah next Wednesday we'll move on to another sahabi inshallah ta'ala.